What is something that most parents do thinking that it is good for their children, but is actually detrimental? Criticizing their children, while not letting their children even question or criticize them back. One might think that, because the parent is older and authority, this makes sense, but this creates either a very helpless and self-hating mentality or one filled with a pure hatred for any resemblance for authority. Sometimes both. Not letting your children be financially independent. I literally didn't have a job or a paycheck or basic life know-how, and I'm still learning shit. My parents paid for college, and wouldn't let me get a job. I didn't get a paycheck until I was 22. They would keep all bills and stuff going to their house, and walking me through my credit card statements at every chance. Sounds wonderful when you think, wow, your parents paid for everything, that's so great. It's not. I resent them for how far behind I felt in life. Not knowing basic life shit like how to get health insurance, or that my car insurance was outrageous. And on top of that, I didn't have my vital records until I demanded them, so I could marry my husband. I could go on and on. But holy shit, did they fuck me up with this. My sister is worse off than me. Not letting their kids fail. As a parent, we want to protect our kids from negativity, but kids who are afraid to fail are afraid to try. Don't let your kid be afraid to try. I shared this story on a parenting sub recently on the topic of letting kids fail, and I think it fits in here as well. My son has the famous Michael Jordan quote, "I've missed more than 9,000 shots in my career. I've lost almost 300 games. 26 times, I've been trusted to take the game-winning shot and missed. I've failed over and over and over again in my life. And that is why I succeed," written on his homework desk in his room. My son's biggest strength is that he isn't afraid of failure. The kid tries everything. He plays football and wrestles despite easily being the smallest guy on the team. He plays an instrument despite not enjoying music. He ran for a student government position with no prior experience. He is currently training for a youth triathlon that he'll participate in a couple of months. He'll give anything a shot. He's still ultra competitive, but his attitude allows him to channel that positively. He may not be the best or the most qualified, but not being afraid gives him an advantage. I tell my kids that I want them to be their best, but I don't need them to be the best. We don't overpraise for accomplishments and we don't chastise for failures. We just expect our kids to correct any missteps. My perfectionist daughter has taken the long road there, but she's finally starting to realize that she has missed out on a lot because of her fear of failing. She's incredibly smart and talented, but we worried about her a lot because of her reluctantness to try. This year she auditioned to perform at a big regional school orchestra event, and I was so proud that she went out for it. Not being afraid to fail is so important. If you are afraid to fail, then you are afraid to try. If you are afraid to try, how do you expect to succeed? For me, it was always having to clear my plate at dinner. I know they were just looking out, but it led to me be accustomed to overeating. Lasted through my teen years. I don't know about most parents, but here's a little cautionary tale about well-meaning parents overreacting. When I was 15, I got caught with a little bag of weed at school and was suspended. My mom thought it was a good idea to put me in rehab and my dad begrudgingly went along with it. Prior to that, I had smoked one cigarette, a Marlboro Light, that my buddy stole from his mom. Hated it, was nauseous, and never planned on smoking again. Fast forward to the outpatient rehab facility that decided it was a good idea for a 15-year-old kid to go to NAM meetings. At this point, weed was the only drug I'd used aside from getting drunk a few times. Well, no more getting high every other weekend, because I was too scared of the UAS. Before you know it, I'm slamming black coffee and bumming cigarettes from people clinging to their sobriety, all the while telling my parents how helpful I find the meetings to be. 15 years later, and nicotine is still a monkey on my back. Years off, years on. Currently a light smoker, mostly when drinking. Nicotine gum always in my pocket. Telling them they can be anything they want, and they are extra special, and then doing things for them instead of letting them strive, fail, overcome, succeed. Lying, not doing due diligence to teach them to answer why, and not teaching effort/failure lessons. My number one is lying. No one can learn the truth if you lie. I don't care if you want the kid to have some bullcrap social constructed experience you have in your mind for them being a kid. Santa isn't real. God cannot be proven to exist. Ideology and belief perpetuate the greatest conflicts and problems humanity has. Tell them the truth. Let them cry and come to terms with reality. They will be far better off for it. 2. Why? Why is the everything question? Someone who never stops asking why is the same person everyone thinks is intelligent in college. When a kid asks why, stop what you are doing. Make it an important moment. Spend as long as you can addressing it and every other question that follows. Show them how you obtain the answer. Teach them to answer their own questions. 3. The number one thing I was told as a child, you can do anything you put your mind to. No, that's complete horse crap. You will fail. You will put your mind to something and then, not being told that it is effort and perseverance that matters, you will fail and give up. Here is the real truth. You can't do everything you put your mind to, but if you never give up then you haven't failed. It isn't failure to be avoided, it's giving up. You will have a point in your life where you have given it your all, where you have done your best and have made no mistakes and will still fail. Parents have this mindset about preventing their children from failure. They need to stop that. Let them fail. Let them learn to have contingency plans. Teach them life is about effort, not what you put your mind to. The slowest, stupidest child will go further than all others if they just keep trying. Not letting kids make their own mistakes. So many parents seem to think that not letting their kids fall on their asses now and then and figure their own shit out means they're bad parents. I think part of it is the parents don't want their kids to ever feel like they don't need their parents, so the parents want to try to keep them helpless for as long as possible. As a result, those kids don't learn how to solve problems, improvise, figure things out or just plain think for themselves, and they always need someone to hold their hand or straight up do things for them. My parents did this with me. They would never ever let me make mistakes and learn from them. They would go so far as doing my homework for me because they were so scared that I was too stupid to do it myself and I might get a bad grade or even be held back. The best part? When I started doing my own homework, I got better grades. Well, there's an autistic kid at school and his parents put him in a separate class than the rest. And one time I tried to ask him how his day was going, and the teacher yelled at me, saying that I could distract him from doing work, and that he couldn't be talked to. Later at soccer practice, he was saying how the teacher always yells at him, and always tells his parents, if he doesn't hear something, claiming that he was purposely blocking out the sound. The parents don't do anything, and they think that the private classes are good for him, so he won't get bullied for being autistic. I think that's messed up. I'm a cop and I love talking to kids. Maybe the best part of my job. I hate when parents say you better be good, or he's gonna arrest you. We want kids to feel comfortable coming to us if they need help or are in danger. I sometimes follow with we don't arrest good kids, just naughty parents. Forcing them to spend time with their bullies, to try and get them to become friends. Really, stop. Just stop. Stop forcing your kids to associate with someone they already have problems with. It will just make it worse for everyone. Instead of your lazy ass actually trying to work something out with a bully's parents or something. Withholding therapy from them if they ask. Some parents have the you'll get over it, or you can just talk to me about your problems mentality. But it's not that simple, especially if the child isn't comfortable sharing all of it, or if the parents are the problem. If someone is requesting professional help, they probably have a good reason. Let me tell you right now, grounding. I don't mean like go to your room until dinner is ready, young man. I'm so mentally screwed because my mom decided to combat my slipping middle school grades by holding me up in the house without any access to electronics or friends until I brought them up. Fairly standard until it kept lasting into 7th, then 8th, and then into high school, and not once did she ask if maybe the school system was flawed, or that maybe her son was messed up by all the talented and gifted BS, which is another answer to the question. Don't fall for that John Hopkins stuff, unless you want to fill your kid with anxiety and learning disorders. Eventually I just started to accept it, and barely ever came out of my room. I now do not know anything about socializing like a regular human, because my mother chucked me into my room for years and wondered why it wasn't getting better. I'm a teacher. Overpressurizing them about exam grades and homework. I hate to say it slash stereotype them, but it tends to be parents of children from a nation background. I had this one kid who came in with his dad on parents' evening. His math scores, out of 110, had progressed throughout the year from about 45 to 78 to something like 105. His dad was angry and berating him for not getting 100%, even though he had worked his ass off and the progress was incredible. That's just not right. Taking something away from them because it's too difficult for them. Unsafe. Yeah, sure. Safe enough but difficult. At some point you have to let them do it themselves, or at least try and fail. I have a friend who was treated like that well into his 20s, and needed a lot of help, and over a decade transitioning from helpless to actually managing on his own. And he's still way in debt too. Comparing your kid with the other kids, when you don't even know what the other kids are like. I bet you none of your friends' parents let them sit at the computer all day. Your friends are out playing in the nice weather. Well, if they are, how come I can talk to them on my Xbox right now? This was years and years ago and it wasn't. Just when it comes to computers. He can do that, why can't you? She is doing this, why don't you like that? Because I'm not them. Spanking. You should never inflict physical pain on a child. All it does is create fear, anger, and resentment. I know this firsthand, because I was spanked as a kid and man, the emotional pain I felt was just as bad as the physical. Where I'm from, youth sports, specifically baseball, are very popular. Parents don't realize that letting your child play baseball year-round is extremely bad for their arms. We've had kids who couldn't throw when they got to high school because of how overworked their arms were. It's minor compared to the others posted here, but it still blows my mind. Too much praise. You don't want a narcissist, but also too much criticism. For example, even if you think criticizing their outfit will help them feel better, it only makes them insecure. As you can tell, my childhood was complicated. Forcing kids to play sports. Exercise is good, but conflating it with competition or professional pursuits can turn a lot off to be healthier adults. It took me years to realize that you don't have to be good at sports to enjoy exercising. Whenever my family went to a buffet-type restaurant, which there were a lot of in my town for some reason, my parents would always make me and my brother get at least two full plates to get our money's worth. Looking back, that was probably a factor of my eating problem. Not even pretending to care about their interests. I get it, you are busy and don't have time to cater to your kids' interests all the time, and maybe you think that's realistic. Just don't be too apathetic. Mom at least feigned interest, sometimes. Dad so obviously could not give a shit. I was always into video games and cartoons, and I don't expect my parents to share my interests, but please, please, when you ask your child what's new, and they respond with that cool game slash TV show comes out tomorrow, do not respond with come on, tell me something real. Yes, my dad actually said that. I don't tell him things anymore. Probably thought he was trying to get me to have more adult interests. Just made me feel ashamed for being 17 and still liking childish things. Privacy. When your kid is around 12 plus, just start knocking before entering their room. Don't scratch through their stuff either. A fair amount of privacy and respect for it will also let their relationship with you develop better and be more trusting in the long run. And I'm sure someone has mentioned it, but don't do the whole look who's finally joined us crap. If they've been in their room the whole day, literally will just make them want to go back and hide in there. My mom preached to me growing up that boys only wanted one thing from me, that they didn't give a shit about my feelings, and that I should never trust a guy because of said desires. All they think about is sex, and will do anything to get it. I know she was trying to protect me, and these things are partially true, but I had a very distorted view of sex, and had a really hard time opening up to boyfriends. It took me a really long time to learn that she was talking about the creeps, and not every dude is a creep. She never mentioned anything about there being good guys out there. Like I said, I know it was well-meaning, but it really fucked me up for a while. I'm going to throw out big parties like every moment in their life needs to be celebrated. Grade 7 prom, of course, you achieved something. themed birthday parties because you're super special. Now, go out and get your minimum wage job and start your life. My parents didn't do this, and we didn't with our kids. They had the option of having a party or an opportunity to hang with a friend and do something cool. They generally chose something with a close friend. Babying them. Making life easy. One day you are not going to be there, and then what will they do? I've had several friends who had parents who paid their bills, didn't make them grow up. And trust me, those are the ones still falling on their face 30 years later. Toughen them up. Be loving but teach them independence and the value of it. I don't know if it is detrimental per se, but sticking to rules 24/7. Okay, so you have a rule that you must always eat X percent of your dinner before you can have ice cream. Good rule. But every now and then, not often, and not particularly triggered by anything, say to heck with it and have ice cream for dinner. Or a picnic on the floor if you're really keen on table manners. Or put on your own boots and raincoat and go and jump in muddy puddles with the kids. The answer to every single fun question does not have to be no for your kids to respect your decisions. Humiliate them when they ignore something, not because of laziness, but just because they never learned about it. Example: during my lifetime. Mom, this thing happened in this city. 8 years old me, okay. Mom, do you know where this city is? 8 years, nope. Mom, you are ignorant. How could you not know that? IDK, maybe because I never heard of this city before, and I'm just 8 years old? There are a lot like these. That's something that makes me angry af about anyone, actually.